I came up yesterday and I did the radio show from the studios upstairs, and I brought my jacket. Nice jacket, huh? I brought the sneaks, very comfortable. I brought the socks. I brought the shirt. And I forgot my pants. What expectations should a 23-year-old girl have in dating? Most everybody you're going to date is a jerk who wants to get in your pants. Anybody want to disagree with that? It's not guilt. Guilt means you've done something immoral, illegal, unethical, or you've pissed off Dr. Laura. That's it. Otherwise, no.
This is The City.
Live.
At SiriusXM Los Angeles Studios.
Los Angeles, California.
Dr. Laura Live.
This
is the Dr. Laura program on SiriusXM Triumph.
Hi. And I have something to show you. I brought two pairs. I thought, I don't know what happened to the, I can't live it down because they put together an itinerary for me. You know, what time I'm going to be picked up, when we're going to be here, you're going to have a lunch, you're going to have to do the show. And at the top of it in big red letters, don't forget your pants. So I can't live this down. They even opened up today with that. How embarrassing is that? All right. Okay. Well, thank you for such a nice welcome. I appreciate it. Now, Lilybug will just, don't worry about her if she wants to come pet you or whatever. You know, it's all okay. Right, Lilybugs? Come on. Come here. Lily, climb. Good girl. Good girl. She'll do anything for food, you know. Me too. They make sure to put where when they're going to feed me and what. And the blueberries have to be the big ones. I'm so fussy. Well, welcome, and I have your questions here, and I'll do my best to give something.
What happened?
Oh, okay. So I'm going to read these and then give some kind of answer that you may accept. I am one of six siblings, all in our 50s and early 60s. Our youngest sibling is a sister, is very unhappy with her life. She never married, never had kids, like she had wished. Her personality is more difficult because of her unhappiness. She is a success in finance exec and has a devoted Labrador. She is very controlling. This went on for days. Is there a second card attached to this or something? And sees herself as the victim very often. She does a lot for our father, as does my other sister. Our brothers help when they can. I live across the country. I fly in. I'm exhausted. I fly in every 6 to 8 weeks. How can I help my sister to understand that her attitude caused by her unhappiness, it's the other way around, but okay. Caused by her, is causing the problem she has. So the question is, how can I help her understand that because she's a bitch, she's not happy? You didn't hear me say that. All right, now you all know the answer to this, obviously, except for the person who wrote this. The answer is you.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. Hello, Dr. Laura.
Hello.
Have you always been against a romantic couple's living together before marriage, or is that a belief you developed over time after your previous relationships? Oh, Jesus, we have a little snark in the you're not being a psychotherapist if you're speaking out of your own personal experience. That's supposed to be separate. So the answer is no. It takes quite a while to really get to know people in all the seasons with all the problems that happen in life. Being romantic is not enough for a long-term relationship. It's not enough. you have to have commonalities of soul and spirit and idea and values and things that you contribute to each other, and you both have to be willing to wake up in the morning and try to make their lives better as opposed to thinking how that jerk can make your life better today, okay? So, no, that takes time. And shacking up while you're taking that time takes objectivity out of the equation, because we're already in a situation where we're more careful, we're more accepting of stuff we shouldn't be accepting of, because after all, we're sharing rolls of toilet paper. So I don't care how old you are, it takes time to make a good decision. And we had a gentleman call yesterday, and I felt really sad for him because he said, well, you know, I was infatuated, and that's not a reason to get married. But when you already have three children in there, what do you do?
Okay.
Why is your audience more female? Well, actually, it isn't. It's almost, it's like 45%. It's very close to half and half. I can't tell you over the years that I've been on that women have come to me and told me, my boyfriend, my husband, my father turned me on to you. The guys call, they write a lot, and you'll notice that if I do a topic for an hour that is male-oriented, boom, the lines fill up. So we women are willing to complain and whine and bitch and moan and groan and agonize over things. Guys don't do that as much, and a little bit to their detriment, because then things build up. Nonetheless, it's not a guy thing. It's more of a gal thing. And, yeah, so it's not. It just looks that way. 60-year-old male, feel in my comfort zone too much, procrastinating, not taking steps toward improving, even maintaining activity level, business, sports, etc. What are the first steps to snap out of it? First step to snap out of it is to realize you're not as bad as you think. The whole thing about sabotaging yourself and procrastination is all about you looking at yourself and thinking, I'm not good enough. Women do this, or I'm not pretty enough. If it's funny, the TV was on in the so-called green room that isn't green. And I always get confused by that. As long as there's food in it, though, I'm good. So it's International Women's Day, which today hardly anybody is willing to define woman. But okay, we're going to leave that aside for right now. We have a whole day for I don't know what. It's all in your mind anyway. And they were just showing products to look prettier. And I thought, on International Women's Day, what we want to emphasize is looking prettier. Never mind, I spent 45 minutes getting this makeup on. So the first thing you have to do as a human being who finds himself procrastinating is you're avoiding failure and rejection and looking bad and all of that. And you got to get to the point of saying, yeah, I don't give a shit. I'm just going to do this. And if I fail, I fail. You got to get to that point. You know, that I don't know how many of you heard me read that letter from that woman the other day. It was amazing. Here she is about my age. And thinking about how many times she didn't wear a bathing suit to go to the beach or a pool because she didn't like if the thighs wiggled. Well, thighs wiggle. And necks look crinkly. And you're just going to hide? Or are you going to say, wrinkly neck and wobbly thighs, I'm going to go have a good time. You know? Because when I'm 20 seconds from dead, I'm going to regret all the things I didn't do because of how I looked to somebody. And most people don't care. And if somebody sees somebody pointing at you and going, see your thighs wiggle, you know what kind of a person they are, not to worry. You are so active and do so much in a day. What time do you go to bed and get up in the morning? I try to go to bed about 9:30 now because the sleep issue has gotten reared up its ugly head. Before 50, I could go to sleep, wake up, that's it. my roommates in college hated me because I would wake up, hi, good morning. And it's like, shut up, I need coffee. And I always woke up cheerful. I hit 50. I mean, right down the line. And suddenly I'm having trouble going to sleep, staying asleep, and it gets worse. So I know certain routines. Don't look at the phone because of the blue light. Take a nice hot bath or shower. I have a music thing that plays noise and sounds and stuff like that. But I go to bed about 9:30, get up about 5. I'm an early bird. So that's what I do. And yes, I squeeze a lot in a day. Rules for having a good relationship with daughter-in-laws. Okay, you ready? You're so cute, I love you. Would you get married again? You got somebody. I mean, there's a lot of people in this room. You don't know anybody who will date me? All right.
How about all the sailors? There's a guy to sail with.
The only thing close to that is guys who golf 94 hours a day. You know, I have this great guy. You would really love him. He golfs all the time. No. I don't want to compete with little pimply balls, you know. Oh, that didn't sound right. I don't want to compete with, no, anything I say after that, it just sounds worse. A long stick, you know. I'm going to go home early. Is it okay to correct a grandchild in front of their parents? If the kid is doing something that's dangerous or destructive, you just have to be careful in how you do it, because, again, it could be your daughter-in-law. If it's your daughter, it's a different thing. If you have a daughter-in-law, you got to be married. So you say, sweetie, honey, let me show you this other thing you could play with. You just do a distraction exercise, as opposed to, is this how your parents are raising you? Best way to tell my husband that I no longer want my father-in-law to live with us. Well, there's no best way. There's less crummy ways, but there isn't a best way. And one of the things you say is, sweetie, honey, I have been very happy to help you take care of your dad these years. It has been a good feeling for me that we do a good thing for your dad. Okay. I have found, though, that in doing this and having him here all the time, that we have less time for passionate, raw sex all over the house. Because he's here. And if he weren't here, I wouldn't be having so many clothes on when you come home from work. So I'm thinking, honey, I'm way ahead of you. I'm not kidding. I would pose it that way because at least it would have humor attached to it, okay? How do I have a relationship with my sister-in-law when I would rather be distant but my husband doesn't? You become the Stepford family member. Hi. How are you? Your house looks very nice. That's it. And then you go home. And then you say to your husband, you owe me. You owe me. Make a deal. Guys are very good at this. I will go and do the friendly, everything's okay thing. What do I get in return? His idea might be different than your initial idea. You were thinking of shopping. He was thinking of... Is it important to renew marriage vows after 10 years of being married? That's an interesting question. I think it's important to renew marriage vows every day. If you want to do it with a party and get more presents, I'm all for that. food. I get to buy a new dress. I like this, okay? But really, it should be renewed every day. And that's why I'm constantly nagging, and I've already said it before here, wake up every day and think how you can make him or her, whoever you're staring at, before you pee and before you brush your teeth, think about what you could do to make them happy they're married to you. That's renewing your vows every day. It's that simple. It doesn't have to be, oh, I hate saying this. It doesn't have to be gifts. I hate that I said that. I am 43 and never had a good relationship. Is it time to throw in the towel? Ah, what can you recommend for people who are likely to stay single? Oh, well, those are two. Yeah. Well, let me just do the back part first. If you're likely to stay single, then you can make a very, very good life with activities, friends, education, traveling. There are all kinds of things. Life has got so many things you could delve into rather than moaning and groaning and feeling terrible about yourself. Now let me get to part one. Never had a good relationship. You know, maybe you did, but it scared you too much. When I was in private practice, I would hear things like that. I've never found a good man. I've never found a good woman. And then you go into the history of it and you find, yes, they did. Not perfect. Not perfect. You always have to sacrifice something, you know. But they did. But they were too scared of ultimate rejection. Because think about it. Everybody in this room has some self-doubts. Raise your hand if you have no self-doubts. Oh, you tried. You were going to raise your hand. We all have it. And what if somebody else knows to think about us the way we just thought about ourselves with self-doubts? And maybe they won't want us anymore. So depending upon, for example, your childhood experiences with how loving and accepting and sweet and fun your family was with you, it's going to make a big difference in how you relate later in life to other people. So if you already have an assumption that you're not enough, that the person is going to get bored, they're going to be pissed off with you and not want you anymore, if all of these negative thoughts, and wouldn't it be nice if you said to yourself, you know, I'm not good at blankety blankety blank, but I sure am good at this, and I could do more of this, which would make me more charming and attractive and interesting to people. So assess yourself. There are things you're wonderful in emoting and things you're not. Okay, so I want everybody to take a moment out and think about something you hate about yourself. Okay, the hate word. Think of something you don't like about yourself. Just think. Tell me when you're ready. On a scale of 1 to 10, how upset does it make you? Give me numbers.
8, 7.
Yeah. Oh, well, good for you. But for most people, it's going to be above 5. Somewhere between 6 and 10. 6 and 9. Yeah. But what do we do with that? What if the other person knows those things and thinks the same as you do about you? Oh, not good. Then how open are you going to be? How vulnerable are you going to be? How sweet and adorable are you going to be? You're scared. So a lot of people turn to being a people pleaser. Just do everything they want. Never argue. In the hopes that we can bypass the 6 through 10 thing. Okay. Go back to the thing that was a, except for Miss Perfect over here. So, I'm just kidding. You're not perfect. I didn't fix that, did I? Okay, go back to thinking of that terrible thing. Let me give you a few seconds to do it. Now, replace it with something that is sweet about you. How does that feel? Do you feel afraid now? No. So it's the work you have to do to undo the negative stuff you keep doing to yourself. Because you do it to yourself. And then you make the assumption that they're looking at you and doing it too. And that's when you become a little testy, a little hostile, withdrawn, kissy-assy, whatever. You do whatever you can to survive. And all you really need to do is go, all right, I have this 6 to 10. Maybe I could change it. Maybe I can't. Maybe I can mediate it a little bit. But, you know, I also have this. And it's wonderful. Okay, so if you can change it to wonderful, then you're going to anticipate that they're experiencing it. So I don't know that you didn't have a good relationship. You just may not have been prepared for it. How do I inspire and motivate myself to continue creating while in a creative slump? Let me think. No. Okay. All right. When I get in a creative slump, that's exactly what I do at first. And then I go, okay, I'm out of here. Do you want to show off a little? Excuse me a second. Hang on to the creative slump. Lily, come here. Sit. Leave it. Leave it. Lily, here. Okay, go get it. Lily, up. Walk. Good girl. Good girl. Such a good girl. I love you so much. Okay, turn. Turn. Sit down. Roll over. Roll over. Up. Yes. Wait, this is the nicest part.
Your creative slump.
Yeah.
And I'm not kidding. I'm not implying you get a dog. But I'm saying you have to do something sweet for yourself because you're blocked. You're frustrated. You're congested emotionally. You just can't. And until you loosen yourself up, and since I got Lily, she is the instant that, Lily, come here. And because she's so loving and sweet.
Right? Yes, I am.
And so you've got to drop. You can't...
You can't force creativity. When you think of creativity, you think of a flow. Well, how can a flow happen when you're like this? You know? So I have times where I walk into my art room, and, you know, I do all kinds of different artistic things. And I walk in, and I look around, and I go, nope. And I turn around, and I just walk out and go do something else, something with her, take a walk, watch a movie, sit in a bathtub, whatever it is, I just leave it. If you get frustrated with yourself that you're in a creative block, then you're more blocked. But if you just relax yourself, it might not happen immediately, but sometimes for 2 days I don't go into my... That's not a pretty view. I did not teach her that, okay? So you don't motivate yourself, you relax yourself. So the motivate word is out. Don't motivate yourself. I'm going to get in a creative mood right now. And also, creativity is often sparked by some kind of new input. When I wrote my books, I would get an idea in my head, absolute truth, I'm telling you. Well, I always do, but here it is. And I would take an hour and a half hike by myself, even before I had Lily Bugs. And I would start writing in my head. Literally, I'd be talking out loud. I'm sure people in the houses where I passed by, she's schizophrenic. Because that's how I would do it. I would look at a tree, a dog, somebody would come out of a house, something would happen, it would be, and it would just move me somehow. And I would write it. Then I would get home and type it. So all my books are first drafts. They were edited for things like, you know, you ever studied German in school? You know, one sentence can be a whole paragraph. If you don't know that, then you don't understand why that's funny, but it's true. So I would, you know, have dot, 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 dashes, and he made sentences out of them. Yeah. My husband of 13 years and I don't see eye to eye. Okay, feed her twice a day. My husband of 13 years and I don't see eye to eye on some things, but instead of communicating about it, when something he's not happy with happens, he keeps it to himself and I drive myself crazy trying to figure out what I did wrong. He is afraid he will hurt me, so he says nothing. Oh, no, he wants to hurt you. I don't mean in a mean way. But guys are very careful because then they don't get sex. He is afraid he will hurt me, so he says nothing. How can I make him feel comfortable enough to share it with me? Sweetie, honey, I can't tell you. Just be sweet to your man. Men like when you're sweet to them, okay? And say, I can see you're really upset. You know what happens in silences? People fill them. So if you say something, I can see you're really upset, he will say something. And if you keep your mouth shut long enough, he'll say a lot of things. But what we start doing is yapping. And just keep your mouth shut and look like you care. I assume you care. Just to let it show. Don't immediately go into, oh, it's me. Then he can't talk about himself because you're back into it's you, which she did hear. I figure out what I did wrong. We personalize the other person's needs and responses. We personalize them. It means something about us. That's very uncomfortable for somebody else to have to deal with. They're talking about their feelings, they're hurt, they're upset, they're angry, they're sad, they're scared, they're something. And you're immediately going, well, how did I hurt you? Why is it me? Are you mad at me? No, honey. And then they stop talking. The thing about men, there are so many differences between men and women, but one of them is that if a guy is up against it dealing with a female, he'll shut up and back off. When on the other side, we keep talking and coming forward. And so a lot of women will call and say, he's just withdrawn. Yeah, because it's not a safe place. You have to be a safe place. It can't be about you. It has to be about listening. Most of communication is about listening. Really listening. What do you think is important for parents of high school seniors to do in their final months before their kids head off to college? Oh, that's easy. If you haven't instilled it by then, have a couple of beers. What's a good mantra for new moms to tell themselves when they're feeling overwhelmed and like the baby has turned their lives upside down? What can you say to yourself to help you mentally get through it? 18 more years, that's all I got to do. 18 more years, 17 more years, that's all I got to do. 16 more years, that's all I got to do. You have to have a sense of humor. Because I remember when my kid was born, he brings me a cuddle. I said, this is so cute. I said, bring them back. Being attended, oh, it's a kid. The day I left the hospital with our son, the nurse said to me, they're not always this quiet. You know, you feed him, he's relaxed, and then we take him back there and they scream for 3 hours. I had no idea that was happening until I went home and went, what is this? And you know, you put them in the car and you drive and it jiggles them. No, that didn't work. What did work is I would lay down in bed, put him in one of those little stroller things. It never occurred to me that I should do the other leg to keep myself symmetrical. but that somehow would work. And then when they are able to talk, you say to, what was so upsetting that you would just cry all the time? They don't remember. You just have a sense of humor, and that's it. Turn on music. One of the things I used to do was turn on oldies rock and roll. And whether he was crying or not, I'd be holding him and dancing to rock and roll. And you can't dance to rock and roll and be upset. I challenge anybody to show me how they can do that. I don't think it's doable. To the ugly music these days, which is all angry. Yeah, okay. Okay. I want to have some fun now. I mean, it's not that I wasn't having fun. Okay, we have all kinds of new swag that I'm giving away here today. I love this one. I am loved by SiriusXM's Dr. Laura. Okay, what color are my eyes?
Green.
Green, who said green? Okay, then. Even I wear one of these. Why do you wear a hat with your name on it so I know who I am? Okay. How much do I weigh?
114,
117, 108, 116, 104, 119, 112, 120, 113. Oh. That's why you were awfully close. I thought, oh God. Okay. What's my IQ?
High,
I'll take high. Okay, a real man would swim through shark-infested waters to bring you a lemonade. I said that one time 30 years ago. Okay, what is my what? Oh, you just want it. Okay, but you got to earn it. Okay, what color is my hair? I suck at throwing things. And you're no better. Okay, where did I put the cards? All right. That's fun. I liked your answer for the IQ. Thank you very much. Made me feel good. Actually, I have no idea what my IQ is. And I don't want to find out, because what if it's low? You know? And I'd think, oh my God, I shouldn't talk to anybody. And what if it's high? Oh my God, I'm not doing enough. And my dearest friend, Jeff Rich, who is here somewhere I can't see, he's just amazing. I'm sure his IQ is about 200. I mean, he plays a million chess games on the internet with people all over the world. So he bought me this electronic chess set that you use to teach yourself. You know, it took me 2 hours to remember where all the pieces go. I got the little rooks because they're all in one line. I like that. No, I couldn't. I don't think like that. And he is just so smart. I want to continue to sparkle just as you do, Dr. Laura. Well, it's the jacket, you know. I married my best friend 45 years ago. And yes, he still holds my hand. I do my best to find joy in each new day, but I still worry about the final chapter of my life, and I know I can't change it. Are you talking about being dead? I mean, I'm sorry, you may not want to admit you wrote that, but there's nothing bad about it. It occurs to me, I get people who come and say, you know, my friend, very active, ate right, exercised, did all this stuff, and just heart attack, boing. And you go, oh, gee, I'm a little out of breath doing that. I've been thinking about that myself. It's something we all have to face. I mean, I can't quite imagine the earth without us in it. Can you? That's just as, you can't either? Let's try it again. I can't imagine the earth without us in it. Yeah. Right, okay. But when you... Yeah, we all have to squeeze the stuff in before we die. That's how I'm looking at the last stage. I'm squeezing everything in before. I have no idea when the before and after is going to be. And I have no idea what happens after that. I have my opinion, but I hope my opinion's wrong, frankly. I'm trying to just squeeze it all in. So that's what I advise you to do. Squeeze it all in. So if you focus on what you don't want to have left behind on the table, you know, and they always talk about when you do a business deal, we're leaving that on the table, we're not leaving that on the table. Don't leave anything on the table. You know, my bucket list is to get a date. Why is that so difficult? How do you develop resilience? I have few issues in my life. Oh, wow, where do you live? I want to move there. How do you develop resilience? I have few issues in my life, but frequently overstress on small problems, so I'm afraid I'll never handle big problems. Well, you'll overstress on the big problems, so what difference does it make? Overstress yourself a little bit, or take the time to go, this sucks. What plan can I come up with? If I can't come up with a plan, who could I talk to that might help me with a plan? I mean, I get a lot of phone calls like that every day. This is because I don't know what to do with it. Sometimes it is because you really don't know what to do with it, but most of the time is you sort of have an idea of what you ought to do with it, but you're too scared to do it. And if you're too scared to do it and you control yourself, then you're going to make yourself more miserable. So I always tell people you have to have the courage to just do it. Again, who gives a shit what everybody else is going to think, unless, of course, you're being immoral or, you know, crappy. But you know when you're doing that. I mean, you actually do know when you're doing that. So if you've never had a big problem, then I guess you don't know if you can handle it. But it's hard to imagine anybody in this room hasn't had a big problem. Let me ask, who has not had a big problem? Raise your hand. Well, then, see, you've been handling them. To get upset is your body's mechanism to protect itself. If you have something very troubling, very challenging, very difficult, very scary, very new and unusual and upsetting and worrisome and painful, God, I have a lot of words for this stuff, don't I? Obviously, the first reaction is the mind and the body are just going to want to get away from that. And you feel overwhelmed. She's just walking on everybody's lap across the... I'm glad you're such nice people. But she's... Are you feeling bad that she's not on your lap yet? So back to being very stressed. You have to be willing to take the big leap. And not only consider how your body and mind are trying to move you away from it. Because that's what's going to happen. All of this wants to protect itself. It's the mechanism of protect. I mean, your skin protects you from everything coming. This is just an operation in self-protection. Okay? So if you allow that to be the only place you go, then you're really not going to be able to solve the big issues in your life. So you have to be willing to take the risk and to be scared and to screw up and to fail and to not do it right and then ask for help, ask for input, because after all, we are a gregarious species and we need each other. Case in point, how many of you are original Trekkies? Anybody know the original? Oh my God, I'm that old. Okay. Do you remember it at all? Okay. You don't have to be Trekkie. Okay. Then let me tell you about one. A lot of them were stupid, even though I love them dearly, but Roddenberry didn't write them all, and that's when it went a little bit downhill in the first years. So they arrive on a planet. You got the captain, and you have Spock with the pointy ears, who has a little mechanism that in each episode does different things. And this little plastic mechanism here can change any language into English. Don't you love it? And now we have Google. Does pretty good. Same kind of thing. But they didn't have it then. They land on a planet, and there's this really handsome dude who was an astronaut in the in sort of our era, okay? And they're wondering how he survived. I mean, Spock is saying, do you realize how old he has to be? This was like in the 60s, and he's still here? And then they watch him, and this cloud of sparkly dust comes around him, and he stands there like this, just surrounded by this sparkling dust. And the sparkling dust has kept him alive, created some kind of food for him to have, water and what have you. So it's been over 100 years, this poor, gorgeous guy is on this planet all by himself. Breaks your heart when you're watching the episode, you're going. So Spock says, Captain, the sparkling dust cloud is female. And it loves him. Now, mind you, this is made in the 60s. Also, having arrived with the captain and everybody else, is a scientist, a female. And in that era, female scientist, she had to be bitchy. I don't know if, see, you, some of you guys are not old enough to know this is how women of high intellectual standings were often portrayed. They couldn't be sweet and wonderful and brilliant. Okay. So she's bitchy and she's complaining and she's complaining and she's complaining and she's complaining. And then Spock says, because everything is on his little tricorder, there's a little problem here. The sparkly dust wants to enter the bitchy scientist's body. And she's willing to let it happen. Because the reason they were on this trek in the first place is the bitchy female scientist is dying. And they have to get her to some planet or she's not going to survive. So there it is. Now the sparkly dust enters the scientist and now she has a body. And this is where it got interesting. Then the scientist who now is, Lily, can you play with your toes later? Come on. Come on. Climb. Just relax yourself. Here, have a little treat. Relax. So the sparkly dust inside the woman's body says, oh my goodness, a terrible thing I have done to this man. I love this man. And now that I see what a human is, it's all encased in this skin. See, she's a sparkling thing that can just be one with the universe. But we are these packets. Look at all the packets that are in this room, and every packet looks different. And every packet has different thoughts and experiences and reactions. And now she feels bad that she kept him alive for 100 years. He must have been very alone. So when she entered the bitchy scientist's body, she no longer was immortal. So now they're stuck. And they're going to stay together, and everybody else leaves the planet. Okay, that was a nice ending. But the part that resonated with me is we are isolated packets. If we don't share and talk and hug and touch and care, we are very alone. And when we feel very alone, we're depressed. So the more you don't share what you're feeling, what you're thinking, what you're wanting, and being open to hearing that from somebody else, with the give and take of what's really inside you, you're going to be depressed. Guaranteed. Because we're in packets. Lust. Haven't gotten that before in a card. Lust is one of the deadly seven sins of the Bible. What is your take on lust? Should it only be reserved for husbands and wives? You can't reserve feelings for anybody. People have feelings. And lust is about a ferocious amount of attention to sex, power, money. You could lust with all... Lily... Okay, where's April? Can April come here and get Lily? Maybe Lily needs to go out and pee-pee. Okay, she's scratching her ear. Okay. Could somebody come in and rescue my dog? Good. I just cleaned her ears out yesterday. Okay. Anyway, so we can, and it's an over-attention to any of those things. And if it gets to the point where your life is totally like a laser beam focused on sex and power and money, it's a very constricted life. So I don't think feelings are a sin. I think acting out on the wrong feelings can be biblically defined as a sin. So I know some areas of religion tend to look at if you even have a naughty thought, you're sinning. I don't buy that, because the brain is able to imagine all sorts of things. And we certainly can't judge ourselves on an itinerant thought. It's the action after the thought that makes the difference, because that's where you have a choice. I have been listening for 30 years, thank you, as long as I have been married. How do we help our adult kids navigate life and make decisions about careers and date? You don't. It's not your job. I'm sorry. How did this get to be parents' jobs? Three, four generations ago, you got to be 18, you got drop kicked out of the house. Go do what you're going to do. Come on Sundays for chicken dinner. You know? This is because you don't have anything in your own head or your own life going on. Don't use your kids as an extension of your personhood. Come on, leave them alone. If they need help and they see you as a reasonable place to come for help and input, they will come to you. If they don't see you as a reasonable place to come to, then they won't. So your job is to make yourself a good couch so that if your kids want to sit and throw their feet up and relax with you, they'll do it. But chasing them around the universe, making sure they're making the right choices, that's you trying to live through them. And you know what? How many, when I was in private, you know what? She shook her head no. I don't know. That's good, because it's a stupid phrase for me to say, you know what? What? So what is she knowing what? So when I was in private practice, I would see the mommy and the daddy and the adult child, usually a male, who would go out, screw up, come home. Go out, screw up, come home again, again and again. And when I was beginning as a psychotherapist, I was still kind of a detective thinking person. I was, what's the ultimate point of this? There must be a reason, a point. Something this young adult must think he's solving. And sure enough, the only time the parents got along is when the kid came home. The adult son came home. Because then they both focused on the kid. Nobody else in the house, they would go after each other or be totally withdrawn. It was a marital problem. And the kid was sacrificing his life to solve the marital problem. And you've seen things like this where I'm sure there's people in this group here who, for their families, was the peacekeeper. Yeah, you realize how much? No, you probably don't. I don't know that you realize how much you have sacrificed to try to keep the peace when it was their job to be peaceful. That's all I have to say about that. Do you think it's okay for couples to sleep in separate rooms? Well, if somebody flips around a lot or snores and they can't fix the snoring, then after you make mad passionate love, go to separate rooms. But I think you ought to have some passion, some sensuality, reading to each other, being sweet. I think before you do that, you've really got to connect. Because then the separate beds isn't really separating you, it's just allowing you to sleep. How can I find happiness in life during tough times in self-employment and business? P.S. I'm glad to be here today. Thank you. I'm glad you're here. That's what friends, family, stupid movies, going out to pizza with some buddies, that's what that's all about. That's what that's all about. I don't know how much more to say that'll sound equally brilliant, but that's about it. You have to have other aspects of your being. You have to be able to listen to music, go ride your bike, go talk to friends, go get together with people, mostly getting together with somebody or some buddies. That's how you survive this. Otherwise, you're just going to drag yourself down. How do I stay in my 11-year marriage if my husband is not a believer in God anymore? He claims he never was a believer in God. Okay, then. Let's assume he's saying the truth that he never believed in God. I don't see any complaints about the marriage or him as a husband. So he got to the same place. You're going to lose that over transient beliefs in God? People go up and down with that, even priests do and nuns. For women who have settled for bad relationships and ignored red flags, what's some advice you have for them to make sure they don't settle in the future? It's hard for me to understand that if you know how and why you settled, I don't see how you're going to be able to settle again. Because you know. You're not just blindly looking around, although I'll be amazed at how many people marry an alcoholic again. Marry a nasty, complaining woman again. We do tend to go where we're most familiar, but we also tend, remember I talked about protecting yourself? Best way to protect yourself is to be in a situation where you can't intelligently, reasonably open up. Best way to protect yourself. Be with an impossible person. Then you have an excuse for not being happy and not opening up. Good for you. One day you're going to die and you won't have this sparkling dust. You're really going to have to understand that we're packets. And you have to connect. If I leave you with nothing else today, you have to connect. And that's an effort because you're a packet. I want everybody to realize when you leave here, you're a packet. Honestly, because I think if you think of yourself that way, then you realize what you have to do to be two sparkling dust. Balls. I didn't want to say balls again. I got in trouble the first time I said balls. Do I have to invite my father, Shack Up Honey, who I do not get along with nor like, to my wedding? No, but that means your dad's not going to be there. Because he wants to have sex with her. So you guys know exactly what I'm talking about. So you won't go to your daughter's wedding. Because you wouldn't be with some kind of woman that was causing strife in your children's lives for no reason. You obviously have your own problems, guys. So you have to understand, if you don't want your father's Shack Up Honey, then you're not going to have your dad there. And considering that, do you care? And I don't mean for show that your dad's not there. I don't mean for show. I mean, do you care? Has he been the kind of dad that it matters that he's there to you? That's the decision you have to make. Because not abiding her is eliminating him, because he wants to have sex with her. When someone hurts me or people I love, I have no problem cutting that out of my life permanently. I sometimes give two chances, but I'm guarded. This personality trait confuses me and makes me feel cold-hearted. What should I do? When someone hurts me. Because your feelings are hurt doesn't mean anything bad happened. Does anybody understand what I just said? Nobody raised their hand. Okay. You listen to the program and you hear, I was very hurt by such and such. And I'll go, it had nothing to do with you. They were leading their lives. This is a situation for them. And this is how they were. They didn't have you in the equation. You put you in the equation. So no, just because you're hurt doesn't mean anything bad happened. So the first thing you have to do is be honest with yourself. does this really have anything to do with me? Probably not, which is good. But that's how self-centered we are and self-protective we are. Oh, this had something to do with me and I'm hurt. So this is where I believe you have to remember you're a packet. And a packet needs to go to the other packet's door, knock on the door and say, I know you were terribly upset. You're all going to act nutty now, right? I can just see this. You're talking to your friends. What did Dr. Laura Schlessinger talk about? I'm a packet. And so are you. But I'm a big believer in knocking on the door and saying, I thought that you did such and such and it meant such and such. No. So you don't have enough information. All you're reacting out of is, somebody doesn't mean to me. Somebody hurt me. Somebody, and I have to go protect myself. Hello. Hello. Hello, sweetie. Mommy kisses. Thank you.
There you go. You, Dr. Laura, you have taught me to be brave. However, I struggle with how to be brave when we have to communicate or confront people who have no insight and are unwilling to grow and change.
I'm sorry, and are unwilling to grow and change. I don't bother. If they really are this resistant to everything, what the hell are you bothering for? Let them get on with their lives, you get on with yours. I don't like confrontations, but I don't hide from one. And yeah, my heart races. Probably if you took my blood pressure when I'm in the middle of confronting something, it's going to be like 2040 over 10,090, whatever. With a heart rate, forget it. I have the same feeling. I just let it happen because I'm going to take care of business right now. You want to see me take care of business right now? All you have to do, all somebody has to do is come in here and bug any one of you. I'll turn into Mother Bear. And does it worry and upset me? Damn straight. I don't let that stop me. That's the thing. I don't like confrontations. Who does? Who really wants to have that feeling and you not know what's going to happen? You just have to learn to control it enough to behave civilly when you're in a confrontation. Just have to try to be as civil as possible, or else you're just escalating the worst parts of each other. But yeah, no. How do I stop micromanaging my adult son? He's 25 and needs to make his own decisions, but I'm always trying to help. I can't even handle that. How do I teach my child that the world is not a dangerous place? What the hell are you talking about? The world's a very dangerous place. Shit, man, why do you think we have security here? Okay. It is a dangerous place. Your job is to teach your child how to recognize it and how to deal with it. That's your job as a parent. Don't freaking lie. Oh, God, do you know any good jokes? Yes, I know one. I only know one. I was at the Crystal Cathedral, you know, the Reverend Schuller. And we're in the middle of the stage, and we're talking about marriages, and he goes, what is one, if you had to pick out, distill one essence, you know, the guy is like this tall, and one essence of what, I said, sense of humor. Swear to God this happened. This is on a Sunday morning. I'm in church. This is a church. I'm in a church telling a joke. And it was the only joke I could remember, and I was sort of nervous, and I hadn't remembered the last line. At some point, I remember the last line, and I'm going, oh, a bomb will fall on this place and only take me out. So, okay, there's this, the head of Japan, the emperor of Japan, wants to have a new head samurai. So he asks all over the world, send me people, I need a new head samurai. This guy comes from China. And he's in all regalia and everything, and he knows he's going to make this. He pulls a little fly out of a pouch. Zzz, ping, ping. Cut the fly in half, and it's dead. Who's going to beat that? So then a little Japanese guy comes up, pulls the fly out. Whoop! Whoop! Meanwhile, I did this, and the guy is there, and I almost hit him in the face. Because I'm doing this, and it's like, oh, shit. Oh, no, I'm in a church. And he cut it in there. Oh, my God, the emperor goes, you cut it into four pieces and dead. No kidding, it's dead. So then this little Jewish guy, this little rabbi comes out, and he pulls the fly out. And the emperor said, he cut it in two. He cut it in four. Your fly isn't even dead. And he and the little rabbi goes, dead, schmed. Can they do a circumcision? And I didn't know what was going to happen, but I thought, oh, I can't believe that. It was the only joke I had in my head. And the whole place fell apart. So he laughed. Everybody laughed. I was good. Bless me. Okay. So I'm out of time. I'm 6 seconds over. However, what we're going to do is as soon as they wrap all this up, if you'd like, you come up and we take a photograph. Mallory takes a photograph and it'll be on a special site that only you can get on to get your picture. And so you can have a picture with me if you care. So thank you all for coming today. Now, what is each one of you? You're a... Yes!